Good morning, friends. On behalf of the School of Engineering and Technology, Indira Gandhi National Open University, I, Rakhi Sharma, Program Coordinator, ACPDM, welcome you all in this interactive teleconferencing program of Advanced Certificate in Power Distribution Management. Friends, as you are aware that we conduct the teleconferencing sessions on the various topics related to the power distribution sector, and for this we invite the experts from their field. Now, I will introduce you to with our expert of today's session. We have Mrs. Anjali Chandra, Director Distribution from Central Electricity Authority. We welcome you, madam.
Thank you.
So this is the interactive session, and we request to ask as many as questions during the presentation. This will make our session more interactive and effective. Now I would request Mrs. Chandra to pick up her presentation.
Good morning, friends, and welcome to this session on Introduction to Power Distribution Systems. As you all know, the power distribution systems have become very important with our slogan of providing power to all by 2012. We are adding a lot of generation capacity, around 78,000 megawatt, and to take that generated power to the consumer, we require our power distribution systems to be very reliable and efficient to be able to provide power to all by 2012. I'm going to take you through a session of the basic power distribution system, introduce you to what is a power distribution system. As we all know, the entire power system consists of generation, transmission, and distribution. We have generating sources. The generating sources are stepped up and transmitted. The power is transmitted through transmission system and finally taken to the consumer through the distribution system. So a schematic diagram of the power distribution system would be generation, transmission, sub-transmission, and then the distribution system. If we look at the structure of the power distribution system, then we have the grid substation. The power from transmission network is delivered to sub-transmission network after stepping down the voltage to 66 or 33 kV through 220, 132, 66 or 33 kV grid substations. The sub-transmission network consists of the 66 and 33 kV lines, which may be overhead or underground. Then the power is stepped down by 66 or 33 by 11 kV substation to 11 kV for distribution. The primary distribution feeders are the 11 kV feeders, which take power to the various distribution transformers. The power is further stepped down to 400 volt by the 11 by 0.4 kV distribution transformers. Then the power is carried through distribution lines to the consumers. If we look at the voltages at different segments of the power distribution system, then the generation voltages generally are 415 volt, 6.6 kV, 10.5 kV, 11 kV, 13.8 kV, 15.75 kV, 21 kV and 33 kV. The transmission voltages are 132 kV, 220 kV, 400 kV and 800 kV. The sub-transmission and high voltage distribution voltages are 33 kV, 66 kV, 3.3 kV, 6.6 kV, 11 kV and 22 kV. And the distribution voltages are 400 volt or 230 volt. The main components of the distribution system are, as we all know, the substations with the transformers and associated equipment, and the feeders and lines with the conductor and associated equipment, and the metering arrangement. These form the main components of the distribution system in our country. First, we'll come to the transformers. A transformer is a device that transfers energy from one AC system to another. A transformer can accept energy at one voltage and deliver it at another voltage. This permits electrical energy to be generated at relatively low voltages and transmitted at high voltage and low currents, thus reducing the line losses. If we were to transmit at the generated voltage, then the line losses would be very high. So, in the transformer, two or more stationary electric circuits are coupled magnetically. The windings are linked by a common time-varying magnetic flux. One of these windings, known as the primary winding, receives power at a given voltage and frequency from the source. The other winding, known as the secondary winding, delivers power usually at a different voltage but at the same frequency. You can see this basic construction of a transformer. We have the core and the windings on top of the core. We can see there is a primary winding and a primary voltage. Then we have the secondary winding and the secondary voltage. So the principle underlying a transformer is that V2 by V1 will be equal to I1 by I2 will be equal to N2 by N1. Here V1, I1 and N1 represent the voltage, current and the number of turns respectively in the primary coil, and V2, I2 and N2 represent the voltage, current and number of turns respectively in the secondary coil. So we can get voltages which are much higher than the generated voltages, or when we go down to distribution, we can step down the voltage to the distribution level through the transformers.
So generally when the electricity is generated at suppose 11 kilovolt and we transmit it at very high voltage,
yes,
suppose 430 kilovolt,
yes,
so the transmission is done at very high voltage. Why?
The transmission is done at a very high voltage to reduce line losses.
Yeah.
As you know, the voltage power is equal to VI. If voltage is high, then I is
less
for the same amount of power which,
yeah,
is transmitted.
Yeah, so definitely this will reduce
I square R losses. This will reduce the I square R losses.
And suppose if we do the transmission at the same voltage, at low voltage, in that case the current will be high. And this will also increase the size of the conductor. And the system will be very costly.
Exactly. So that is why we have to transmit over long distances. For example, we are generating sources are at the pit head.
Yeah.
For at the coal pit head. So if we are generating at Singrauli and we want to take power to say Punjab or J&K,
yes,
then the distance will be 1,000 kilometers or so.
Yes.
And to transmit power over that distance at low voltage, we'll be incurring heavy line losses and very high costs.
So the transmission is done at very high voltage,
very high,
and the distribution is we use the
step down transformer
to reduce the voltage level and use for the distribution,
yes,
purpose.
Exactly.
Now,
so that is why we are using transformers in between the generation and the distribution.
Yes.
So the rated power of the transformer. A transformer should be provided with more than one primary winding or with taps on the winding if it is to be used for several nominal voltages. Otherwise we have a two winding transformer, and the rated power of the transformer is the sum of the VA volts or amperes, volts into amperes, for all the secondary windings if it has more than one winding on the secondary side. Primary side will definitely have one winding. It could have more windings on the secondary side. The efficiency of the transformer is the ratio of the output power to the input power. So when we talk about efficiency of the transformer, we talk about the ratio of the output power and the input power. Energy efficiency is also the ratio of the energy delivered and the energy injected in the system expressed in percentage terms. We could also write it as efficiency is 1 minus losses over input, because input minus losses is the output. So the efficiency of the transformer is maximum at a loading as a fraction of the full load current when its iron losses equal the ohmic or copper losses due to current flowing in the windings. In the transformers, as we all know, there are two types of losses, the iron losses and the copper losses. And the efficiency of the transformer is maximum when the iron losses are equal to the copper losses. The voltage regulation of the transformer is the ratio of voltage drop in a transformer from no load to full load and the no load voltage expressed in percentage terms. These are the terms connected with a transformer, the efficiency as well as the voltage regulation.
So ideally the voltage regulation should be zero.
Yes, but that is not possible.
That is not possible. But the efficiency of the transformer is, I think, maximum in all other machines in the used in electrical.
Yes, because you know the efficiency of a transformer is in the range of 98% to 99%.
Yes.
For the power transformer, it is higher, but and for the distribution transformer, it is still lower. But in terms of efficiency, it is quite at a very high level because it's more than 98% generally.
Yeah, it's because this transformers doesn't have any. Rotating part.
Yeah, exactly. It is a stationary piece of equipment.
So no friction and other losses are there.
Yeah. Only the iron losses and the copper losses. So the types of transformers. We'll go into the types of transformers. We have various types of transformers. As per core construction, they are the core type and the shell type. As per phases, they are the single phase or the three phase. We have as per windings, single winding or two winding transformer. Then we have as per voltage, step up and step down. As we discussed earlier, step up from generating to transmitting and step down from the transmission to distribution. Then as per application, we have power transformer and the distribution transformer. So these are the various types of classifications of the transformer. You can see a power transformer here. This is a 33 by 11 kV power transformer. This is a distribution transformer. We'll come to the various types of power transformers and distribution transformers when we discuss about substations, but these are generally distribution transformers are smaller, whereas power transformers have MVA ratings, whereas distribution transformers are in KVA.
This is mounted on the pole.
Yeah, this is a pole mounted distribution transformer. I would like to go into the differences between a power transformer and distribution transformer because that is very relevant to our power distribution systems. The power transformers convert power level voltages from one level to another in a grid substation or power substation with voltages at 33 kV and above. The distribution transformers step down the primary distribution voltage of 11 kV or 22 kV to secondary distribution of 400 volt between phases and 230 volt between phase and neutral through delta star winding. Power transformer. Since it is fed through the grid network, a power transformer is usually not a critical component for supply to consumers as alternative paths for flow of power are available through the grid. We can have two transformers, and usually there are two transformers in a substation, so even if one power transformer is out, then we can supply power to the other transformer. There may be a bus coupler in the substation, so we can shift the feeders to the other power transformer. In distribution transformers, they are generally connected to the consumers through radial feeders which have only one path and have to be continuously energized for maintaining uninterrupted supply to consumers. Now we have started having ring main systems in which when the distribution transformer is off, we can switch supplies. But generally the distribution transformers are radial, therefore they are very critical to maintain uninterrupted power supply to the consumer. Then power transformers are most of the time loaded to levels just below the rated power, and accordingly they are designed to operate at maximum possible flux density level with maximum efficiency at near full load. Distribution transformers are mostly lightly loaded, and in order to have maximum all-day efficiency, they are designed to work at low flux levels with maximum efficiency occurring at lower loading, because the load factor is low in distribution transformers. Then we'll move to the configuration of the transformer. The transformers in a distribution system can be configured either as single phase primary configuration with three single phase transformers, or we can have a three phase configuration, one three phase transformer. Three phase transformers are connected in delta or Y configurations, as we all know. Delta configuration is used for three wire transmission and sub transmission system. Y or star configuration is suitable for four wire distribution systems. A Y delta transformer has its primary winding connected to a Y and its secondary winding connected in a delta. A delta Y transformer has its primary winding connected in delta and its secondary winding connected in a Y. So now we have discussed the basic transformer. We'll come to the feeders. By definition, the feeder consists of all primary or secondary voltage level segments of distribution lines between two substations or between a substation and an open point. You can see the diagram of a feeder. We are all very familiar with feeders, but this shows what is a distribution feeder. We'll come to the configuration of feeders. Feeders are connected in a configuration which depends on the type of network required in the distribution system. Three types of network are normally available in the electrical distribution system: the radial, the loop, and the cross loop network. Radial distribution feeders, which are radial, are the most common. The radial feeder emanates from one point and ends at the other in the radial network. Load transfer in the case of breakdown is not possible. Although a radial feeder can be loaded to its maximum capacity, in the case of breakdown, quite a large area may remain in dark until the fault is detected and repaired. As I told you, the radial feeders are being most commonly used in our country, and we have not yet started in the distribution systems with ring main units. In radial system, if the feeder goes down, then there is a complete breakdown till the fault is detected. This is the example of a radial feeder. So there is no other source of supply. If there is a fault on any section of the line, then the entire feeder goes off. Then we have loop feeders. In loop arrangement, two feeders are connected to each other so that in the case of a breakdown, the faulty section can be isolated and the rest of the portion can be switched on. In this type of system, the feeder is normally loaded to 70% of its capacity so that in the event of breakdown, it can share the load of other feeders also. So we design it in such a manner that it is only loaded up to 70%, and it can carry 30% of the load of another feeder. At least the essential load can be shifted to this feeder in case of breakdown on the other feeder. You can see this is the example of a loop network. So there are isolation points in case of a fault. The section which is faulty is isolated and load shifted to the adjacent feeder section. Then we have cross loop network. A cross loop network provides multiple paths, and the flexibility further increases. In case of breakdown in any line, the faulty system can be isolated and supply can be resumed very quickly. In this type of network, feeders should normally be loaded to 70% of their current carrying capacity. This system is highly reliable but very expensive. It is even more expensive than the loop network, and definitely much more expensive than the radial network. So you can see that there are multiple paths to any section of the system, and whenever there is a fault you can shift loads to the other systems, and because there are multiple paths available, the reliability increases quite substantially. But due to resource crunch, we are generally going in for radial systems. Now we'll go into a comparison of the radial, loop and cross loop systems. In the radial system, single path to each group of consumers is there. In the loop distribution system, double path to each group of customers. In the cross loop network, we have multiple paths to each group of customers. The radial distribution system has the lowest construction cost, the loop distribution system has medium cost, and the cross loop network has high cost. The radial distribution system is simple to plan, design and operate. The loop distribution system moderately simple to plan, design and operate. And the cross loop network distribution system is complex to plan, design and operate. But it has the highest reliability. There is no reserve, and loss of feeder implies loss of supply in radial distribution system. Mainly used in rural areas, can be used in urban areas also. In the loop distribution network, loss of feeder results only in temporary loss of supply used in urban areas, and the cross loop network, it has highest reliability, therefore it is used in large cities and for critical loads like hospitals and other institutions which require continuous supply, and it is used in mainly metropolitan and urban cities. Then the feeder or lines, depending on the manner of laying, can be classified as overhead and underground. A conductor is used in the feeders and lines, and we'll go into what is a conductor. A conductor is classified as a material that allows flow of electricity with minimal resistance. Metals primarily make up this category, as you all know, and the two metals that are used in most power transportation applications are copper and aluminium. They are the conductor of choice because of their non-magnetic characteristics and of course their low resistivity. A conductor's current carrying limit is known as its ampacity or its ampere current carrying capacity. The smaller the wire, the greater the resistance for any given length, all other factors being equal. A wire with greater resistance will dissipate a greater amount of heat energy for any given amount of current, and the power being equal to P is equal to I square R. So the smaller the wire, we'll have higher resistance, and the greater the size of the wire per unit length, we'll have lower resistance for these other factors remaining the same. The specific resistance is a property of any conductive material, and it is a figure used to determine the end-to-end resistance of a conductor given length and area. Therefore, R is equal to rho L by A. That is how, if the length and area and resistivity are given, then we will determine the resistance of the conductor for finding out the losses. So the types of conductors which we are using in our system in the power distribution are all aluminium conductor, which is commonly known as AAC conductor. Then the aluminium conductor steel reinforced, which is ACSR, and the all aluminium alloy conductor, which is triple AC, which is known as AAAC. These are the three types of conductors we are commonly using. We'll go into each type of conductor. ACSR, which is the aluminium conductor steel reinforced, it is this comprises of a coarse steel with strands used for support that is encompassed by aluminium strands. The technical specifications of these conductors are covered in IS 398. The common names for ACSR are squirrel, weasel, rabbit, commonly used in distribution. So as I have shown, 7 by 2.11 is the squirrel conductor. It has a current carrying capacity of 115 ampere. The weasel conductor is 150 ampere. The rabbit conductor is 208 ampere. You might be a bit amazed by the animals which are coming in this conductor. These are the brand names given to conductors on the names of animals, and smaller the animals, then smaller is the conductor size. Higher the conductor size, bigger the animal which name which is given to it. Squirrel is small, therefore this has a lower current carrying capacity. We have, after rabbit, we have dog, panther, wolf, goat. We have many sizes of ACSR conductor, and they are all named after animals to give them a common brand name. The numbers in bracket indicate, for example, 7, that indicates the number of strands, and the other figure in bracket, for example, 2.11, 2.59 and 3.35, that indicates the diameter in mm. Then we have all aluminium conductor, that is light in weight and is used for LT lines. Then we have the triple AC conductor, which is the all aluminium alloy conductor, which has high resistance to corrosion, particularly in saline atmosphere. Therefore, it is used in coastal areas where there is a lot of salinity and the ACSR conductor gets corroded very fast. The AAC and triple AC are also used so to reduce the possibility of theft of conductor. In many instances, in some of the states, we find that the conductor itself is stolen where it is ACSR. So to reduce that, the double AC and triple AC conductors are being used by some of the power utilities, and they are also used due to their advantages of being light in weight and higher resistance to corrosion. The ACSR, AAC and triple AC conductors are used for secondary distribution systems. ACSR conductors are preferred to AAC conductors for long spans owing to their greater tensile strength. We do not use AAC conductors in long spans. We use ACSR conductors. So I have just put down what are the various conductor types used at different voltages. At 33 kV voltages, we are generally using panther, wolf, dog, or equivalent triple AC conductor, and XLP cable of 150, 185, 240 and 300 and 400 square mm. At 11 kV, we are generally using dog, raccoon, rabbit or equivalent triple AC aerial bunch cables, equivalent aerial bunch cable. We'll come to what is an aerial bunch cable. Then XLP cable of sizes 120, 150, 185, 240 and 300 square mm. In low tension distribution network, we are using dog, raccoon, rabbit, weasel, double AC conductor of ant, grasshopper, wasp or equivalent triple AC. We could also use equivalent aerial bunch cables, which may be 3.5 core or 4 core, and PVC cables of 95, 120, 150, 185, 240 and 300 square mm. These are the conductors generally being used. Then how do we select the conductor size? The size of conductor is selected in view of the following factors. Its current carrying capacity. What is the load on the system? So the current carrying capacity should match the load. Then the current that the distributor has to carry is calculated on the basis of the load incident on the conductor, including anticipated load growth. You cannot keep on changing the conductor every now and then, so therefore you take into account the anticipated load growth to decide the size of the conductor. We then choose a conductor size capable of carrying current at the ambient temperature of the area, and this is selected from the standard current tables, because the IS gives the standard current carrying capacities of the various conductors, which is given in IS 398 and its latest version. Then the allowable voltage drop or line regulation. The voltage drop is calculated taking products of loads and their distances and the resistance of the conductor. So the voltage drop at the end of the at the tail end of the feeder should be within limits. These voltage drops limits are given in the IE rules 1956, and for LT distribution network these are ±6%. So if you want to find out the conductor size, you should take into account that the voltage regulation at the tail end of the feeder should not exceed ±6% in any case, in all conditions of power supply. Then the breakdown strength of the conductor. We have to take into account the external loading, the wind speed, the ice loading, and the ambient temperature. Then the internal characteristics, the stranding, modulus of elasticity, thermal expansion, and creep. Then the other consideration is the line voltage. The higher the line voltage, the lower will be the current. So therefore, line voltage plays a very important part, because V and I are in dependent on the power, and once V is high, I will be low. Then the economic loading based on capitalized cost of losses. We should have a conductor size in which the capitalized cost of losses over the life cycle of the conductor is the lowest. It is not only the initial cost which is important, but it is the life cycle cost, the capital investment plus the cost, capitalized cost of losses, which should be considered while selecting a conductor size. Here I have given some of the electrical properties of all aluminium conductor. We have various sizes, the size of the conductor, the area, the resistance per kilometer at 20 degrees C, and the approximate current carrying capacity at 40 degrees centigrade and 45 degrees centigrade. For example, rose conductor has 116 ampere current carrying capacity at 40 degrees C and 108 at 45 degrees C. Similarly, all aluminium conductor of NAT, called NAT, has a current carrying capacity of 133 at 40 degrees centigrade and 123 at 45 degrees centigrade. Similarly, Irish would have 150 amperes at 40 degrees C, and at 45 degrees C it is 138. We have ant conductor, which is again the name of a small insect. These all aluminium conductors are generally named after insects or flowers. So ant has 204 at 40 degrees C, and at 45 degrees C it has 189 ampere current carrying capacity. Then these the aster all aluminium conductor has 239 at 40 degrees C and 198 at 45 degrees centigrade. These are the electrical properties of ACSR conductor. Like we discussed, squirrel, weasel, we have already seen. Then ferret, it has a current carrying capacity of 181 ampere at 40 degrees C, and at 45 degrees C it has 168 ampere. We have mink, which has a size of 0.06 square inch. It has a current carrying capacity of 234 at 40 degrees C and 217 at 45 degrees C. A dog conductor, which is 0.1 square inch, has 325 ampere at 40 degrees C and 300 ampere at 45 degrees C. We quite frequently hear of dog, squirrel, weasel, and raccoon conductors in the power distribution system. So these are the current carrying capacities of the various conductors. Then we will come to the types of distribution systems. depending on the voltage of distribution, the distribution systems are classified as low voltage distribution system and high voltage distribution system. The low voltage distribution systems were being commonly used in our country till quite recently, and the high voltage distribution systems are now being adopted. We'll come to what are low voltage and high voltage distribution systems. A low voltage distribution system, or the traditional system which we have been using, comprises of 11 kV lines laid up to the distribution transformers, from where the LT lines are extended to the consumers through an extensive overhead and underground network. The transformers are of high capacity. They may be of capacities 250, 100 kVA, 630, even 1000 kVA. The individual connections are given to the consumers from these LT lines through service cables. So we have a large network of LT lines when the distribution transformer size is high. For example, 250 or 300 or 630 or 400, then we have to have a large LT network for supplying to the consumers. And we have been using this traditional LT distribution system for a long time. But in this practice, the three-phase transformers, as we know, with large ratings are used, thereby causing large voltage drops and loss in power. Because LT line has high currents and the size of the conductor is also such that I square R loss is very high. The line loss in LT feeders is quite high. We have long LT lines, and the loss in each LT line due to high currents is quite high. Then the LT lines are affected adversely with the voltage drops due to large consumers like welding machines, motors. Even 1 in 250 consumers could affect others, leading to severe voltage drops at consumer end, high line losses, regular voltage fluctuations, and the main problem in long LT lines is that the LV lines provide opportunity for unauthorized tapping and hooking. Whenever there is an LT line, then we have heard of that kundi and the hooking system whereby consumers do theft of energy. You can see this. We have people hooking directly onto the LT lines, whereby they pilfer energy and cause a loss to the genuine customers as well as to the utility. Because the voltage is low, they tend to make a direct tapping, which is quite substantial in our country, because as you all know, the T&D losses in our country are of the order of 30%, and they comprise quite substantially of commercial loss, and this commercial loss is mainly due to theft, hooking and pilferage.
Yeah, so the power, this theft or pilferage of power, this is the major reason of the commercial losses.
Yes.
In high T&D losses.
High T&D losses in our country, this is one of the major reasons.
Yeah, and that's why just to reduce these losses, we are learning this course and how these losses can be minimized.
We'll come to.
This is a major factor in the distribution sector, the high T&D losses.
Yeah, exactly.
So we will discuss this in detail in the next sessions.
T&D losses will be discussed in detail, but I wanted to introduce that why are we moving to high voltage distribution system.
Yes.
You know, this low voltage distribution system, lot of people are hooking on to the LT lines.
Yes.
So that is why we are moving to high voltage distribution.
This is HVDS.
Which is popularly known as HVDS.
Yes.
So you can see this, if you would like to see that, this is the status of our distribution lines, where
yes,
people are hooking on to lines directly, and this is the status in one of the areas in Delhi. This is a picture of Delhi. So you can see how people are hooking on to the LT lines. So to avoid this hooking as well as to reduce the technical losses, the concept now is to move on to high voltage distribution system. In the high voltage distribution system, we use small capacity distribution transformers instead of large capacity distribution transformers. instead of the 630 kVA or 1000 kVA, we have now moving to 5 kVA, 10 kVA, 16 kVA, 15 kVA or 25 kVA, where a few number of consumers get power supply from the transformer. The LT lines are minimized. People do not generally tap 11 kV lines. There are instances where people have got transformers and are transforming 11 kV to LT, but these are very few. The ordinary consumer does not try to tap an 11 kV line. So when we use a high voltage distribution system, the 11 kV line goes very near to the consumer and the transformer is installed just outside the consumer premises. When the 11 kV line is going very near to the consumer, the size of the conductor used for the 11 kV line is smaller. As the current is lower, the voltage profile is better. Usually the consumers complain in an LT distribution system that they are getting very low voltages. But in a high voltage distribution system, because the 11 kV line is coming right near to the consumer, we can maintain a high voltage at the consumer premises.
And monitoring also become very easy in this case. And that means this reduce the pilferage.
Direct tapping at least from the line is avoided to a large extent. Line losses are much less because in the LT length line is reduced. It is very small. It is just from the pole to the consumer. The connection is given directly from the pole to the consumer. The LT length will be very minimal, so therefore the losses will be much less. So reliability of supply improves due to the following reasons. Failure of LT line, HT line is much less in comparison to LT. And since a limited number of consumers are fed by one transformer, the fault in a single transformer does not affect other consumers. And theft of electricity is practically eliminated. So if we compare HT and LT distribution for the same quantum of power, then you can see the comparison of losses. In a HV single phase HV distribution system, the losses are 8.5 kilowatt if they are 100 kilowatt in a LT distribution system. The current is 11 ampere as compared to 100 ampere in a LT distribution system. Voltage drop is 12.7 volts as compared to 100 volts in a LT distribution system. So you can see the advantages in terms of voltage, current and losses. You can see this is the example of a high voltage distribution system where a small transformer is installed on the pole, a single phase distribution transformer. We'll go into the various types of HVDS when we move ahead with these lectures. You can say this is another high voltage distribution transformer installed outside the consumer premises. This is another high voltage distribution transformer, small capacity, installed because it has a small capacity, it is very near to the consumer. So if we see the cost comparison, then the advantages observed is with the HVDS system is reduction of LT overhead line loss, then there is no pilferage, the unauthorized consumers are brought into the billing net, and we have a better voltage profile and reduction in interruptions. So in the end, we go that we install meters are required to be installed at various points of the distribution system, and the various types of meters are the interface meter, the consumer meter, and the energy accounting and audit meter.
So now we will take the short break of the 15 minutes. Now, Mrs. Chandra had discussed on the various aspects of the power distribution system. We have seen about the conductors, transformers, we have discussed about the feeders, and what is the LT system, what is the HVDS system. And after the break of 15 minutes, we will discuss further about the substation equipments. Thank you.
Thank you.